Digital age. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on stage Miss Manisha Koirala, actor. Miss Mithila Palkar, actor. Mr. Priyanshu Painyuli, actor. And Miss Shrishti Arya, director for International Film India Netflix. And to moderate this discussion, I'd like to invite on stage Miss Rosella Stephen, associate editor, The Hindu. Over to you, Rosella.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone, for being here. And as Akhila had introduced our guests today, they need no introduction, just like how Netflix needs no introduction. It's got us to binge over the last 3 years. But to begin with, there's Manisha. We know her from 1942 Love Story, from Khamoshi, from Dil Se, and more recently from Lust Stories, where, you know, she was in Dibakar Banerjee's short and played this assertive, powerful woman. It was fascinating. Manisha, of course, has, you know, had this journey as a cancer survivor. That came into play last year with her book, which introduced us to a very different side to her, and it's also played a very strong role with how she has selected her projects going forward. So there's something again with Netflix, that's Dibakar Banerjee's Freedom, which we're all looking forward to. And there is Maniratnam's 99 songs, I mean ARMR's 99 songs, so that's again something we're looking forward to. So she is going to talk to us today about what it means to be a star with over 80 films to her credit, but in her late 40s, revisiting her career, working in projects where she's not necessarily the protagonist. It's very interesting. So she's going to take that side of the discussion today, and will be followed with Mithila. Mithila is an internet star we all should know if we don't yet, because she has a following of what, over 2 million, right? And is active on all those platforms. She was a YouTube star, and then of course Netflix came in with the second season of Little Things, turned it into such an amazing series. And it's interesting when I look at her, because she is able to create her own kind of storytelling. So Mithila will tell us about being the present, which, you know, considering that last night she was singing for her fans on Facebook. Okay, so she knows what she's doing. So she's going to talk to us about that. Okay, and then we have Priyanshu. Now Priyanshu, of course, is the past and the present. In the sense, he's been around for a while, but he was in Bhavesh Joshi superhero. That's Vikramaditya Motwani's Avenger film, Vigilante film. So he's been through that, and then Netflix came in, Netflix gave him Upstarts, and then he's become a household name. He's a Bangalore boy. I mean, he's got Delhi and Bombay to his credit, but he has spent his time in Bangalore making films, videos, African videos, he tells me. So he's got all of that to his credit, and a lot of theater. He's done, what, 120 shows, right? Around the world. I mean, it's interesting. So he's got that, and he is starring in the Chris Hemsworth potential blockbuster that will be coming out later this year from Netflix. Yep. So with Sam Hargraves and, you know, the whole Russo camp. So he will be talking about the future, because the future is looking very bright indeed. So that's it for Priyanshu. And finally, we have Shrishti, who is the lady boss. She says she's not that at Netflix, but she is she's that. And she is the common link between all of these artists. She's worked with each of them. And she's also the person who's green lighting very interesting projects at Netflix. And if you follow her on social media, you will get FOMO, because there's one project after the other, which is this Muscat. Oh, I forgot about Muscat that's coming up with Manisha. So, you know, that's a Parsi story, has a lot of food. So, so yes, so Shrishti is the woman behind the scenes who is pressing that button. Okay, so let's begin with Manisha. Manisha, let's start off with how it was for you when you came back. And like we discussed, you know, it's not the same. I mean, we look at you as this great person. We remember all your films, unforgettable, many of them. But you're willing to take chances, be a little experimentative. At the same time, you know, it's not easy. So could you run us through that, please?
Sure. First of all, I want to say thank you to everybody, and namaskar to all of you. It's a pleasure to be in Bangalore and among such people. Getting into the OTT platform at my age, trying to reinvent, restart a career which has done almost 90 films. And the times were different, the style of acting, quality of cinema, the storytelling, the narratives were different. And to try to fit into today's flow of life that is happening, it takes a lot of effort. It's not easy. I will get on to it later on. I don't want it to be only about me. For me, I had to study what's working in the market, what younger generation are watching, what are the things which is being appreciated, and what are the good new directors I could be working with. And so it so happened that when Lust Story happened, I was very apprehensive initially, trying a short film, which was again new for me.
And against type, you know, it was very
different. And again, a different kind of a setup and everything. But I think something happened and I said yes, and I was very apprehensive, very scared how people will perceive me, how they will see me, and but it all worked, so I was very happy for that.
Good. And what about you, Mithila? I mean, from the first season of Stranger Things to the second, as we were talking about, different directors. I mean, sorry, Little Things, my dear.
I'm going to move on to that.
It still goes with the Netflix story. But anyway, Little Things, the first season and the second, this huge change, because that's when Netflix stepped into the second season.
Yes.
Different director. Everything was different. Complexities with the characters. And on the side, you also have your YouTube videos. You have, you know, all of that going on. Filter copy, you know. Your audience, your fan club, which continues. So what was it like for you to get in to the Netflix family?
Oh, it was, the kind of propelling that happened for Little Things because of Netflix was unfathomable for us, because the first season was on YouTube. Little Things did have an audience undeniably after the first season, and everybody loved it, everybody wanted to watch more of it, and that's when and how and why we were encouraged to make the second season, and Netflix stepped in for us. And just to know that just with a click of a button, you are available for people in 190 countries and so many million subscribers at the same time is just, these are numbers that are just mind-boggling. I'm anyway not great at math. So just to know that, like, there are so many people watching you and there are so many people liking your work, it was incredible. It was just a different kind of jump for us from where we started.
But about being the star of today, as we, you know, introduced you, you are that. I mean, the sense, you know, you are, you know how to work this whole media.
Oh, that's very kind of
no,
you.
No, it's true. It's true. Because, you know, yes, you know how to do that. So, like, you were, what, at some fish market on some YouTube show identifying local Marathi fish, you know? Seriously. True story. She does that on the one hand. She has this cup song sequence from Anna Kendrick, which I think she's been asked to do 100 times, so we won't ask her to do it here. But she will sing for us later. Anyway, so she's got all of that. So she knows her game, and it's very interesting. So can you give us a little more about that?
I think what was most exciting about doing what I do was that when I started, I started as an actor who wanted to, I mean, as a person who wanted to act. I wanted to be an actor, and that's all that I knew. Filter Copy gave me an opportunity to be a part of a show that they were doing called News Darshan. It was a news satire comedy show where I'm just sitting and reading news. But that was something that I was open to experimenting with, because all I knew was that I wanted to be an actor. I didn't know how to get there. Of course, I started auditioning for everything that came my way, whether it was ads, whether it was films, whether it was television. Any opportunity that I got, I wanted to jump on it, because the dream was to be an actor. Internet happened as part of one of those experiments. At this point in time, I don't know what I would have done if that wouldn't have worked out.
But you didn't have a plan, no, going back.
I did not have a plan.
Yes, didn't have a plan. And you're good, because I've seen some of those shows where you've told, you know, your audiences that it's okay not to have a plan.
It is okay not to have a plan. It's important to have a goal. I think it is the plan, if there should be any, this is a complete personal choice and opinion. That the plan, if there should be any, should be to work towards your goal consistently, and that's something that I follow. So even the growth on the followers, as you mentioned, on Instagram, or followers on YouTube, or followers on Facebook, all of this for me happened organically. I may be introduced somewhere as a digital influencer. I had no idea what it meant until I was called one. So, because it was all so organic, because I got to learn everything as it was happening, because I got to be part of the internet revolution, where the internet became a legit medium of entertainment.
You're
today.
A native at the end of the day, I think. Yes.
Yes. I mean, that's something that I'm very happy and proud about, that I was part of that change, and I was, I could contribute in whatever little way that I could, because I think since the last 4 years, it's been a phenomenal growth, and I mean, it's only
just with that cup song. If you can tell our audiences here how that, you know, just changed overnight, the numbers.
Yes, I was I was doing videos of Filter Copy anyway. I did a couple of sketches with them, and then one afternoon I just decided that the rhythm of the cups I had learned during one of my summer breaks in college, and I wanted to do something with it. So I said, okay, why not? It's a basic 4-beat rhythm, which a lot of songs fit in. I said, okay, I'll experiment with a Marathi song. So I just sat in my friend's house, who held the camera, her mobile phone camera for me, and I played that song, and then I just decided to put it up on YouTube. Because I wanted to share it with everybody. So I put it up on YouTube, I put it up on my Facebook page. And overnight, I remember it was 11th March, 9 o'clock in the evening, and my phone started hanging. I remember the time, because it was again, something very unfathomable, something I didn't do it so that it goes viral. Nobody can tell you what goes viral, by the way, because this is a question that we get asked a lot. How do you make viral content? There is no formula to that, actually. So I didn't make it so that it goes viral. It was just something that I wanted to experiment with. I experimented and I shared it with people, and my phone started getting notifications after notifications. It was hanging because there was just suddenly such a sudden influx of messages, and I was getting notified for whatever, like DMs or emails or shares. Next morning, there was a journalist who called me and said that we'd like to interview you. And then the barrage of interviews started, and things just suddenly, that was literally an overnight change for me that happened. Like, even for my grandparents who I live with, they were like, what is happening? Journalists are coming home, clicking photos, and now you're in the news. And I was in the news for something that I thought was just for fun. And then I started getting messages from all across the globe, people who don't understand the language. Within India, not too many understand Marathi, right? Because we are such a diverse country, we speak so many different languages, so every region has their own language. And in spite of that, everybody was listening to the song and saying, we're just listening to it because of the melody, and this is something that we've enjoyed listening to. So that for me was very new, very fun. It was a pleasant surprise, and that's something that I started then learning from, that this is now... This is going
how
to be
it goes.
Yeah, this is going to be the life now. Yeah.
Okay, now Priyanshu, with you, especially with your theatre, which you were telling us about, you know, worked with Rajat Kapoor, worked with, you know, a whole list of really interesting people. And then you've also worked, you know, in that company in Bangalore. So there's, you know, the technicalities of what goes on behind creating videos or, you know, content. So for you, with, let's say, Extraction is going to open you up to a completely different audience. Upstarts already has. You told me that you were recognized in Taiwan, of all places, right?
Yeah.
On the streets. So, you know, that, I guess, shows you the potential of how things are changing. Where do you see yourself, and how are you going to plan this journey?
First of all, Namaskara, Bangalore. Thank you for having me here. And I think I'll start off with the Bangalore. What Netflix has given is coming to Extraction. So when I was in Bangalore, I was studying here. I was dreaming of becoming an actor in Bombay. Then I shifted to Bombay, and we go there. And then, as Mithila said, no, don't make plans. I had lots of plans, and nothing worked. And you go to Bombay and you're like, nothing is happening according to my plans. And then you go there, then you struggle, you take your time. And then my dream of becoming a Bollywood actor happened, thanks to Bhavesh Joshi. And then I did a couple of films. But I had not thought or even dreamt that in such a short span of my career, I would be watching Avengers. And the next thing I know is I'm part of a Russo brother film. So that I had not even thought of. And suddenly that happens is, and then you realize that the web has given you, that's what I think all of us believe in, that your stakes go up, your audience is global, and you're getting an opportunity. I'm doing an Indian Netflix film, suddenly I'm in a Russo brother film, people are going to see me all around. And that Taiwan thing is, I got a free acupuncture session because the doctor's kid recognized me and he said, oh, Bhavesh Joshi, and he had seen the film in Chinese. So I think globally, when people start recognizing you, you wanted to be an actor, and now you just want to do different kind of stuff. So I think my next dream, which I can easily say, is to get an Oscar. And I know, but that, you know, why not? Now, I never thought that I would be in a Russo brother film.
Nice.
But now I can dream that big. I can think of those kind of things. I can go to that level ki Martin Scorsese will see my film and then, you know, call me for his next
Irishman
film. Because that's what is, I mean, he's already Irishman 2. So I think, because... So now we're not restricted with the kind of content we're making. We're not restricted with the kind of work we're doing. As Manisha ma'am also said, we are exploring ourselves so much. We're opening ourselves. The writers, the directors, actors are getting such opportunities that we have to step up. We're playing the game globally around. And that's happening because of Netflix.
So also tell us a bit about how you got this role. Because, you know, you don't necessarily speak that language, Bengali. And, you know, there was something to it. So quickly tell them what
happened. It was a surprise to me also, because I think, so I'm playing a Bangladeshi in the film. I won't talk much about what I'm playing, let it be a surprise. But I think I just got a call from Tess Joseph, is the casting director. She mainly casts for most of the international films. And she said, do you speak in Bangla? I said, no. She said, your name is Priyanshu. I said, yes, but I'm from, my hometown is Dehradun. I've grown up in Bangalore. I don't speak in Bangla. She's like, can you try? She had tested me before for other films. I said, okay, but what is it? And they generally don't tell you in the first go, you know, that it's this kind of film, this big. I said, I can try. And that time I was sitting with one of my Bengali friends. She's also an actor. She was in Tumbad. I remember we were watching Tumbad. Post Tumbad, we come out and I said, just WhatsApp me some of Bengali lines. And literally some lines like, bade bade sheharon mein choti choti baatein hoti rehti hain, senorita and all that. I had said it in Bengali on WhatsApp and sent it to them. They said, yeah, he sounds Bengali, just call him for audition. I was like, okay, this is... But then I got two scenes where they said, this is in Bangla and this is in English. And I've been told, which I feel very, very great, that they were looking for a 40-50-year-old guy to play this character. And suddenly they went with a 30-year-old me, where they said, let's just try him, and I got the part. So I was like, okay. And then I confirmed it 10 times with Tess, saying, this is a Russo brother film. This is the Russo brothers, the ones who made Avengers. Like,
Also, you have a way with accents, and you translate everything. You do work with the Davangiri, and then you kind of, is there something like that, where everything works for you? Because
so that the musical show, that 120 shows which I did around the world, that was with Vaibhavi Merchant. Mm-hmm. It was her Bollywood kind of a show. We used to call it a Yashraj movie on stage. It was four actors, 40 dancers, massive sets, you know, 2,000 costumes. We never got to do it in India. We traveled around the world. We used to stay in France, do it for a month. you know, go to Russia, go to different countries. So we did 10, 12 countries. We did 120 shows there before I left it. But whenever we went to any country, I would try it because I was also the narrator of the show. I tried to include some of the local language. You know, so I did some Chinese songs in China, speak in Russian, and then French. I remember speaking the whole, like I did the whole show in French.
Not knowing a word of it.
Wow.
No, and after the show, I come out and people are meeting me and they're like, Trabia. I'm like, oh, merci, merci beaucoup. That's all I can, I can't speak in French. I can just do the show. Yeah. So I think I got a hold of how I can catch up with languages. And mainly it was listening to them. I used to record voices, write that in Devanagari. Anything if you write in Hindi, it becomes much easier because of the matras and accents we have. That's how I did Bangla. I think I trained for 2-3 months and then when I went on set, I was not talking to anybody. I said, let me just give my shot. And Chris Hemsworth comes and speaks to him like, yeah, hello, 1 second. I have to concentrate on my line. No, that did not happen, but I did. I was kind of on set. I had to really, really concentrate because it's not my language. It's not in English or Hindi where I can, you know, improvise or play with the wordplay or say something else. It is totally an alien language for me while I'm acting.
So Shrishti, there's, you know, let's say that we had an interview with you recently where you talked about the original content in local languages that's come in already, 100 I think, and then you're going to have another 120 coming up. At the same time, you have people, audiences in India, thanks to Netflix and of course other streaming platforms, who are opening up to Spanish and to Korean, to Japanese. African. They're coming up with African content soon. So how does that figure when it comes to Indian content also being introduced in a similar manner? What are the plans?
I think when we talk about doing content, we like to start with the story and always kind of work back from there. And we'd like to make sure that our creators get to tell the story in the best form that they want to and in the language that they want to. In fact, we're working on a film right now, which will come out a little later, so I'm not going to name it. But it has...
It's a typical Netflix thing. Everything is a suspense, a mystery, and on embargo.
Well, you know, you'll enjoy it more when it's on the service. But we have this... it's about this Maharashtrian family. So they speak Marathi. But it's a Hindi film. And it's set in Kerala. So the kids have grown up there, so they speak Malayalam.
Wow.
So when they want to mess with their parents, they speak in Malayalam to each other. Because they know the language, but the parents who grew up in Maharashtra don't speak it. And of course, there's English that they speak in school. So we want to tell every story in the best possible way that it needs to be told. I think, like, you know, the director of Parasite said that don't be intimidated by that one inch, which is such a beautiful way and kind of succinctly puts what our philosophy is at Netflix together.
Yeah.
We want to make sure that there's dubs and, you know, people can enjoy authentic storytelling in the language that they want to, while the creators get to create it in the language that they want to.
Correct. But as a favorite favorite critic of mine said, Bharadwaj Rangan, you know, we've been used to this sort of thing thanks to Didi. You know, the subtitling and all the cinema we watched on Doordarshan used to have. So we're kind of okay with it, but it's nice to kind of, like, let's say Korean and African and all of that is a little new for us.
It's not just the subtitling. We also do extensive dubbing.
Subbing and dubbing, both of
them. I was just going to say that. I think that's the one. Another thing about Netflix is that everything is dubbed in... I know Little Things is dubbed in 7 different languages. So, like, different Indian languages at the same time, international languages. So, it's not... Subtitles obviously are there. But apart from that, every single line is dubbed in a different language.
And it's dubbed very well. Because I saw Money Heist, I thought it's an English show. So, I was watching the first 2 episodes, my language, I hadn't changed it. Then somebody said, did you watch that Spanish show, Money Heist? I said, I've been watching it in English. I thought it's an English show. But it's dubbed so well that you don't realize. Even when we dubbed Upstarts, we dubbed it in English in all voices. So that, you know, people can,
and also I think talking about Spanish, Veronica is a big hit, isn't it? In India,
it is.
Hot, the horrors.
It was much loved. Yeah.
So, getting back to Manisha, about, you know, you're talking about earlier about auditions, and you know, among the many things you're getting used to in this ecosystem, one of them being auditions. I remember in another talk you talked about Vidhu Vinod Chopra, the audition for 1942, which didn't go well the first time around.
Yeah, I mean, there have been very, very few auditions that I have done, actually. And probably for Saudagar, which was my first Hindi film. And then 1942, A Love Story, which the first audition didn't go well. But in today's time, whenever an international film is offered, you have to audition. And I'm not so good with it. So I have tried because I need to study the psychology of the character and the upbringing. I come with a whole
in deep.
Yeah, then only I can bring. So, and in today's world, what I was doing one film recently in US, and somebody who was much younger to me, they were auditioning like 15, 20 films per day while she had breaks in between shots and all that. So you're so tuned in to do these things. And for me to do one audition will stress me out. You know, so I'm still getting a hang of it. I don't know. Yeah, it's not my thing.
So what about you, Mithila, auditions?
That's the only thing I know.
See the difference?
That's where I started. It's been my school in a sense, because I didn't go to a film school and I just decided to be an actor. And that's something that my family always pointed out, that you just have these dreams, but you've not really you have to dive into the deep end of things to actually know if you can do it. So I think auditions then, back then, were my deep end, because that was my only on-field, in a sense, kind of learning. When you play different characters, it's how you, practically when you do these things is when you learn better. So yeah, but I still audition.
Yeah, I'm guessing everybody has to, right? I mean, what do you...
There are workshops now,
yes,
how to give auditions.
Yeah, oh, really?
Are you giving
those Nandiri?
Are you a...
No, I don't take it. I would say take workshops for actors to just for learning and, for dialect or whatever.
I should join that.
these are specifically to learn how to give auditions. But yeah, I really like giving auditions. I love giving auditions. It's like a playground. It's somewhere where if you're sitting at home, there's a little lesser philosophy it might sound, but I'm saying if you're a runner, you have to run every day to win the race, right? So as an actor, if I'm called for audition every day, I'm anyway acting it out. Otherwise, I'm sitting at home. If I act or sitting in the middle of a cafe, then people think I'm mad. So it's better that I go for to my auditions, and it just keeps me in my exercise. I'm learning something new every day about myself. And the casting directors knowing me, and they're updated with my talent. So I think it's good to just keep giving auditions. That's how I think. And also now the good part is that there's a systematic way of everywhere in any of our films that it goes through a casting director. You're given a good synopsis, you're given a character brief, and then you give a proper audition, and only then you get selected for the part. Yeah.
So that helps. But when he was talking about acting and that whole, you're constantly acting, do you think sometimes it can be a bit of a pressure when you are, most of the shows that you've done, you've come across as this feisty, independent young woman, who speaks her mind. And then gradually, do you think a lot of the projects that come to you have a bit of that?
Yes, I do. I do think so. But at the same time, because we have auditions in the system now, it's important to do that, because that's the only way that us actors will get the opportunity to even explore that side of us. I know that it becomes harder for filmmakers to envision us in a different role or as a different character, especially when you've played different shades of similar people, I guess. Or I would say that those characters have been shades of...
Also because you've had a public persona, at the end of the day. You know, there's also all the YouTube videos you do those.
Yes, but I do understand that it can be a hindrance, but I'm glad that we can audition and that can showcase that side of us also. Like Priyanshu very rightly said, it is also a way of honing our own craft. Like, there is no other way that I can play different characters and know if I can do it well or not. So auditions are great, are a great exercise. I think it is important also because of, I'm just repeating myself, but that's the only way that a filmmaker will know that I will be able to do it or not.
Correct.
Because if they are only going to reference my previous work, then they will probably not know that I can play a darker character maybe. But having said that, Chopsticks, the girl that I play in Chopsticks was completely on a different radar than
but
I was.
But Karwan, I mean, I'm guessing some people was back to a little bit of that.
Yes, correct. So I have been fortunate to have...
And what about the Kajol film that you...
That is actually also...
Different.
Thank you for bringing it up. It's different.
That's coming up in 2021, isn't it? Or we should ask Netflix. Wait.
Priyanshu, the number of languages you do would be very useful.
Come on.
I will come for the audition. No, it's been very funny. What she's also saying is right, because then some times people don't see you doing anything else. You know, that is also good, because before Upstart, I did 4 features. Out of that, 3 mein I died. Okay, like I had a rock on
correct,
2.
That's true, yes.
Like I had death scenes in all 3, and people emotionally connected with me. And I remember sitting with casting director, and I was giving narration where after half like interval, I was again dying. So I had 2 more films which were narrated to me where I was dying. I said, nee, I don't want to do film for me. They're like, no, you have a nice sweet face. People emotionally connect with you when you die. I said, but that's not why. So thanks to Upstarts, where I told people that please watch my Netflix film. I'm there till the end, and it is my story, and I'm not dying. Yeah.
No, but seriously, going back to this whole, you know, creating stars, we've all noticed that there is a role that Netflix plays, very protective when it comes to your stars and, you know, the stories and the properties. Does that extend to the creative side of things as well when it comes to directors, script writers? Give me a little more about that, please.
I think we don't kind of think as being people who are creating stars. We like to believe that we enable creative people to come out and tell their best versions, right? Like to go back a little bit to the audition story. The point of doing auditions is, like Mithila said, to have people show different facets even to the directors. And part of the creative enabling goes all through, from the writing to the direction to the actors and throughout. So we'd like to think that we are a place where you can come and do your best work. And, you know, that's another reason for you to stay connected with us throughout. And not like position ourselves as like we create anything. What we would like to be known for creating is good stories.
So enabling. Possibly. Okay, so when it comes to actors, yes, you play that role. What about with directors? I mean, digital stars are created there as well. But when it comes to Netflix, I see a lot of the pedigree directors. How is that going in another direction as well? I mean, going forward, what can we see?
The thing is that when you have people who are already known, people tend to remember just those. So out of the 24 films that we've announced, there are a number of new directors, there are new female directors, then new male directors, then new female producers, then new female writers. We've been very lucky in terms of the balance we've been happened to get. But yes, it's a few names that people are familiar with that get stuck in their minds. Like we had a new director direct Upstarts for us.
That's true.
Right? And we have a new director who's done Maska with us. And it's, Sachin, who directed Chopsticks, was not like very famous, but yet people only connect to Vikram or Dibakar, and you know, part of that is like, so what happens is that we tend to be sticking to the familiar, and what we're trying to do is to break those kind of habits and have a healthy mix. Our idea is to program for whatever mood that people are in, for whatever frame of mind, whatever they want to watch at that moment. So for that, sometimes you will lean on people who've done it before, and sometimes you want to.
And I think also, given the fact that you come from that background, it is a little more easier. I think it is your family, your industry, basically, right?
It's a privilege.
Yes. So she had, of us who do not know, I mean, she has a past as a producer, and one of the few brave producers who decided to get into television.
And started very young.
Yes. So that's her. Yeah.
I'm still young. Yeah.
But I think I'm sorry, but to add to what she's saying and something that we were discussing also backstage, that I think platforms like Netflix pan everything. I'm not just saying as actors, as directors, as storytellers in general. I think platforms like Netflix have democratized opportunities, I would say. Because now we're finally telling stories, and we're not, it's not just about a hero and a heroine and a villain, and they're stories, and we are all here to tell stories, and we're all just mere storytellers, and that's what we are being enabled to do.
Correct.
Yeah, I think it's a great time. Different content, you know, the different narratives, like love stories for me. You know, it wouldn't have been possible many years back if the platform like Netflix hadn't happened. So directors, I remember Dibakar, when he approached me, he said, Manisha, now we can make films that we want to make.
Like not worrying about ticket sales.
Markets and ticket sales, and not driven by that fear. So there is a freedom. So, thanks to the platforms like Netflix.
There has to be some kind of fear, I think. So, what would that be? If it's not ticket sales?
Excelling yourself. And actually not misusing the chance that we've got. So, actually trying to do our best. And so, this kind of a setup can either work magically or it can fail.
So we all are trying to make it, because it's a great platform. It's a great opportunity for an actors, for writers, for producer, director, everybody. And like everybody said before, is like people who probably wouldn't have gotten an opportunity to make films or tell stories before are getting the chance now. So this for us becomes very precious. So we are putting our best foot forward so that this is a success.
I think also the fear, it's not a fear, we have to push our boundaries now, because what happens with a Netflix content or a film is people are, it's a personal watch, right? They're not in a theater, they've not taken a ticket.
It's a family affair.
Yeah, it's not a family affair. They've not gone inside the theater where you've caught them anyway for 2 hours. Now they will watch it after the interval also, whether the second half is good or not. On a Netflix film, they're watching it at home. A bell rings, they'll be distracted. Now, are they going to come back to watch your film? If a phone rings, they're gone with the phone. So you have to hook them with such a good content and quality that they will sit and watch your first, I mean, sometimes they watch the first episode. If they don't like, they will not watch the rest of the episode.
Sure.
So that is becoming very, very challenging. And I think that is good for us, because if the stakes go up, we push ourselves and, you know, our work becomes much more better and we feel satisfied.
And also, like, sorry, but another part of it is that because you're at home and you're not having to, like, kind of go book an Uber, get to a theater, you know, get dressed nicely and go with your friends, you're also more open to trying out new material. Like,
yeah.
We've put out this film just yesterday called Ye Ballet, and we're kind of hoping that it's going to be able to find an audience that would not necessarily go and make the effort, but it's right there being served. And once you get in and you see the first 5 minutes, you'll be hooked, because it's such a beautiful story.
And it's no longer that first day, first show, Friday collections, whatever. You know, it slowly seeps in, and you might watch it or discover it after 5 months. So, you know.
This is the best part, when we are doing our kickoffs and we like kind of talk to our creators and tell them how the Netflix product works. And when you tell them, you know, your content is going to be premiering for the rest of its life. Every time somebody sees it, it's premiere night for them or premiere day for them. It's so exciting to see their faces, to know that, you know, it's limitless.
Yeah, it is limitless, which is very important. I think in terms of even the kind of content that we create is limitless. It's just, the way the content is consumed is, like, those ways are limitless. And I think, and whatever everybody else said.
Yeah, now your people like can't make excuses that they haven't watched a film. Because with my theatrical films, which do not have, unfortunately, do not have good release, like Bhavesh and stuff, people said, "Arey, it's all out of the theater, we missed it." I said, "But it's there on Netflix, you can watch it anytime." Now Upstarts, it's there on not Netflix, watch it later. Whenever you watch it, it's yours. You know, that's the point, that's the best thing. And also many times, I think how many of you here, people think there's a lot of traffic, yeah, we can't drive till the theater. That's become the biggest problem today, or buying those popcorns and cokes and, you know, watching a film in the theater. So people like it personal. We're giving them any time, just watch it. On the phone nowadays, you can watch a Netflix film.
Yeah, so you've also said, I mean, earlier that, you know, this whole idea of, because it's streaming platforms and, you know, they can be, the censorship is not necessarily there. You know, you could have cuss words and nudity, and you've said it's not necessary all the time. So could you kind of expand a bit on that? Because
Yeah. I think people who use nudity and cuss words only and promote that can't write good scripts. They can't make good content. That is why they're only using those kind of elements to promote their project or their film. Because if you can write good stuff, all these nudity and cuss words will be just part of it smoothly. I mean, we were discussing about sex education, the show. It's so brilliantly made that it teaches you more than you watch a sex scene and you're like, hey, what are they doing? They're not selling it on that. The idea is not that. I think that when you can't make a good content, then you fall back into all these cheap methods.
I feel like any kind of responsibility that is given to you has to be anyway used very wisely. I think it is every artist's discretion to say something or do something or, you know, use certain tools. You can only do it if you think it's important for your characters, if it's important for your story. I feel like the internet generally gives you the kind of liberty, like I've always drawn the parallel to what art is. Like it is so liberating and so free, and that's what the internet lets you be, that's how it is. But that does not mean, like, if given a finger, you shouldn't hold the hand, is what
I
believe in.
True. And even when you're creating, when right now, thanks to Netflix or Amazon or any of these streaming platforms, you're more accessible. people watch it intimately. They watch it on that one gadget or, you know, with their headphones. So they think they know you far more than earlier. So for someone like you, Manisha, because you're a star of those days and now, how is it, I mean, do you notice a distinction when people approach you? They feel like they know you more now?
I personally don't really feel that because I've been in the scene for the last 30 years. So it's for me, it's not really new because I think people already know me.
But being more accessible to them, where they're willing to just come up to you and speak to you as opposed to before, they would be a little more, I think, no. It's,
no,
yeah.
I haven't faced that.
No.
I haven't really faced that. So, but yes, I think the celebrities and the stars are far more accessible and far more, whether it's social media or the projects or, you know, the platforms, different, are there. And that's the flow of life. That's the trend which is going and people are loving it. And, you know.
Also, this whole idea of storytelling for most actors. Now, you need to know the craft. You know that craft. We were talking about this, Priyanshu, where you said you need to get some tips from her on that craft.
I'm very bad at social media. I'm still learning that,
same
you
here.
Know, you check the insights and this time people see your profile, this time you have to post all this.
But do you follow that?
It's difficult.
The timing and all of that. I think she'll tell you it'll come.
No, I have to learn from her. I have to.
But I think for me, because it happened, like I told you earlier, it happened so organically that, like, as my followers were growing, I was growing, my followers were growing, and my audience who has watched me since the Cup song has, there are a few of them who have stuck around still. I mean, it's very kind of them to have, but yeah, I mean,
really stuck on me with the numbers.
but for me, I've never really taken that pressure of every day I have to make one post or every move of mine has to be put on a story, because I can't do it. Like I can't get
how
myself.
How does it work? For instance, the song that you were singing last night on Facebook. Now that was that planned or
so?
How does that
so
work?
I in between decided to do something called hashtag Sing Song Saturday. So on my Instagram, I sang every Saturday. Also, it helps me because that puts me in the discipline of trying to sing at least once in a while. I am not a singer, but
you're going to sing that for
you
us.
You are a singer.
Please, come on, you are a singer.
There I try to.
There are actors who can't sing. There are actors who can sing. That is why.
There are actors who try to sing. So yeah, so that's something I did, and I had not done it for a little while, and there were people recently who actually wrote to me in my DMs and who met me at some events, and have very in the recent past have told me that, why have you stopped singing? So yesterday I just felt like it, so I put it
up. Do you feel emotionally connected with the fans? Because I've got messages, especially thanks to Instagram, that people are have sent me an Instagram message saying that we are in the interval of Bhave Joshi. You know, we just saw the film and you died, we've cried, and are you coming back in the second half?
It
touches you, no?
Yeah,
you feel like,
they just come back and forth.
That's certainly, I did a show for, it was called Soulmates, a web series, where I'm playing a confused guy. After every line I say, I don't know. A lot of youngsters who are writing their exams watch this show. They've sent me mails, they've sent me long messages. A guy wrote, I'm crying while I'm writing to you. Because this is me on screen, what you have portrayed. This is me because I'm so confused. And I said, it's okay, it happens in this time of life when you're writing exams and you're trying to figure life. Don't cry right now. But I mean, they connect with you so personally and you feel emotional looking at such messages because they're so personal messages.
I think the main takeaway is that by coming onto streaming, you're enabling people to tell stories that are more relatable. You're talking about stories that, you know, like a great story can come from anywhere and can travel everywhere. So what happens is the kind of characters and the kind of things that you get to do make you more kind of accessible in that sense. But I don't think that it's a question of, because there are many ways that people consume. Like we optimize for like 1600 types of screens.
Absolutely.
Right? So it's not like, it's not a function of that. Yes, social media, on the other hand, has made actors a lot more, like you can send a DM to your favorite character.
And at Netflix itself, you have your YouTube channels. I mean, there's that as well. So everyone says there's no escaping Netflix. You think you can, but then you go on YouTube and then there's something there. So, you know,
we have a
that's done consciously,
that
obviously, to get people.
Oh, the content team is quite on it, like even on their Instagram.
Yeah.
But there is another parallel that I always tend to draw is the one thing that I absolutely enjoy being on social media as a public person is that there is no wall. Like, finally, yes, you're not untouchable. I also think that I absolutely adore theatre. It is my first love and it will always be.
I think for Priyanshu as well,
even
isn't it?
In fact, we've worked with the same company. Yeah. But you know how, like, after a play, people can come backstage, come speak to you. There is, like, instant gratification or not of sorts. And it's similar, right? Like, people can watch your video and immediately, like, yeah, respond to you. If there is something that they want to say to you, they can slide into your DMs and just say to you. So it's, I think that is something that I, that interactiveness of it is something that I enjoy the most. Because in fact, what hurts me is when somebody says, like, somebody writes to me and says, I saw you, but I was scared to, like, approach you. And that is my biggest pet peeve. Like, you can't think of me as someone who's, like,
I saw some comment that said, ma'am, you are a killer. Sell you this after your last night's song. I saw that. And I was
what
like,
all have you?
I have. Like, I've been awake.
God. Amazing.
Yes. Okay. So it's been really interesting, but we have to open it up to the audience for questions. So the lady in orange, please.